Charlie, can you remember what today's theme is? No, neither can I. I've completely forgotten. Gosh, what can it be? B, that's it. Hello, and welcome to Swizzle Street. No, I didn't mean bees that fly. Look, let's have a look at a bee that flies. This bee is just about to land on a flower so that it can collect some lovely pollen to take back to the hive and make some really nice honey. What do I mean by a hive? Well, a hive is where bees live. No, not letter bees. Flying bees live in hives, bumblebees. Look, let me show you. This is B-E-E, and that's a flying bee, okay? Now, the other sort of bee is the bee that comes between A and C, and that's a letter bee. Do you understand? Good. Gosh, that was getting really complicated. Well, today's show is all about the letter B. So everything we do is going to start with B, and we start with a book about a bad bear. Once upon a time, there was a bear who was so kind and thoughtful that all his neighbours were his friends. The bear liked to go for long walks, and one day, at the top of a hill, he found a wagon. It had been left there by a woodcutter. The bear had never seen a wagon before, and he walked all around it, sniffed it, and at last, he sat on it. To his surprise, the wagon began to move, and as it rolled downhill, the bear felt rather frightened. But by the time it reached the bottom, he was really enjoying the ride. He liked it so much that he pushed the wagon right back up the hill and rode down again. Time after time, he pushed the wagon up the hill and rode down at great speed. "Cool, this is fun," he thought, "but I don't like having to push the wagon up the hill very much." Well, every day he rode the wagon from morning till night. But the more he enjoyed the rides, the more he hated the hard work of pushing the wagon uphill. Then he had an idea. He went to look for his friend the raccoon, and he told him all about the wagon and the wonderful rides, and invited the raccoon to come and see it for himself. Well, the raccoon was naturally curious, so he went along with the bear. On the way, they met the deer. "Come with us," said the bear, "and have a ride in my wagon." Of course, the deer was naturally curious, so he went along with the bear and the raccoon. On the way, they met the goat. "Come with us," said the bear, "and have a ride in my wagon." Well, the goat was naturally curious, so he went along with the bear and the raccoon and the deer. In a very short time, they were all riding down the hill at a wonderful speed. "Hey, this is lovely," said the raccoon. "This is marvellous," said the deer. "Great, just great," said the goat. At the bottom, they all got out, except the bear, who sat tight. "Hey, come and help push," cried the raccoon, the deer and the goat. "What, me?" said the bear. "If I let you ride in my wagon, the least you can do is push me back up the hill, don't you think?" And he looked so fierce that his friends were too frightened to argue. So they all went riding on downhill, and the raccoon and the deer and the goat went on pushing the bear back to the top. "What shall we do?" they whispered to each other. "This is really tiring, but if we give up, the bear will get us. He's not his usual kind self at all." Then, when they were pushing the bear uphill for the 100th time, the goat had an idea. "Listen," he whispered urgently, "I know what we'll do." And the others bent their heads towards him and listened to his plan. Well, the bear was busy enjoying the scenery and noticed nothing until they reached the top of the hill. Then, "Right," shouted the goat, "over the top with him." And the wagon with the bear in it went hurtling down over the other side of the hill. Faster and faster sped the wagon until it crashed at the bottom, and the bear was flung out head over heels and landed right side up in a shallow pond. Plop! But, worst of all, when he looked round, he saw all the other animals of the forest standing on the bank and laughing at him. "Well, it serves you right," they said. "It was very unkind of you to bully your friends like that." But they helped him out of the pond and they set the wagon upright for him. "Now you must push the raccoon, the deer and the goat uphill," they said. "And when then you'll know how they felt having to push a great heavy lump like you." So the bear pushed his friends up the hill, Not once, but many, many times. And each time he understood just a little bit more how badly he'd behaved. At last he said, "I'm truly sorry for what I did. I won't ever do it again." And at that, the raccoon, the deer and the goat invited the bear to climb into the wagon, and they all rode downhill at a glorious pace. And at the bottom, they all got out and pushed the wagon back again together. Well, I think Charlie's gone to have a look and see if he can get a ride in the bear's wagon while the bear's still feeling friendly about it. Actually, I don't think that bear was very friendly to do something like that to his friends, and I'm certainly glad he learnt his lesson. Well, here is a completely different type of bear, and this is a polar bear. This huge white animal lives in the North Pole and has a thick white coat to protect it from the cold. It even has hair on the soles of its feet to keep its feet warm and to stop it from slipping. It's actually related to the big grizzly bear that we model our teddy bears on. Well, those bears look really cuddly, don't they? They're so cuddly and lovely. Well, changing the subject completely now, I was moving house this week and I found a half-empty bottle of tomato sauce. And I wondered if we could do anything with it on Swizzle Street. So I've devised a way of doing bag painting with tomato sauce. Now what you need, first thing you need, this will please Mum and Dad, is some newspaper. Don't start doing this without newspaper. Then you need your bottle of sauce and some sort of sandwich bag, like that, for keeping goods fresh. Now perhaps a smaller one might be a little bit easier, but I've got quite a large one here. Now this is the bit that I love. And I'm going to tip it all in here. You can use mustard if you like, but if you use mustard, make sure you use a spoon. There we go. Tip it all in. Ooh. Get it right in. Now you see why we're going to need newspaper. Leave that there. And then squeeze all the air out of the bag and seal it up. Like that. Once you've sealed it up, get some sellotape. And just make sure that you've sealed all the holes completely. Ooh, it's my teeth. Just so that all the tomato ketchup doesn't squeeze out. And then what you should do, I'll put that there now because it's all sealed up, is to squash it down so you've got a nice flat pad. And then you can start drawing in it. So this is like a personal painting board. Now, let's see if I can do the letter B. Down. I think I might have a little bit too much tomato ketchup in there. But if you press with your fingers, you can get, you can't see that very well, I know, but you can get a letter B. And then to erase the picture, you simply squash your hand all over it again, make it a nice smooth base, and then you can start drawing something else. And I think it's great fun to be able to do something like that. Well, there's some other people who've been working very hard with some pictures, and they have in fact sent me some pictures for the gallery. So why don't we have a look at them? The picture in today's gallery is of a beautiful big red heart with two people inside. And that's by Catherine Kelly, who's A7. I think somebody's holding a big balloon there as well. And here we have A Dark Starry Night with a pink cat by Michelle Thorley, A6. Looks like somebody's gone to sleep beside the cat as well. And here we have A Smashing Treehouse. What a fun place to play in. And that's by Robert Diaper, who's A6. Looks like the little boy in the picture might be Robert about to play. And here we have a very pretty little girl with a hat on. And that's by Nusheen Ansari, who's aged 11. Some lovely balloons there with big, happy, smiley faces. That's by Adil Ansari, aged 5. Really bright, lovely colours there. Well done, Adil. And finally, we've got a little Easter chick that's wandered onto the gallery. Little pretty yellow fluffy one by Zaim Ansari, A7. Well, I've got another picture that I didn't manage to fit onto the gallery, and that's of a butterfly, and that's by Joanna Duffus. She's coming onto the show a little bit later to show us something that she's done, but that's a smashing picture. Well, talking of butterflies, here's a whole collection of butterflies. Here are literally thousands of butterflies, and some people get quite confused between butterflies and moths, but there is an easy way of telling them apart. Butterflies always fly in the daytime, and moths usually fly by night. These beautiful butterflies would have started life as an egg, which hatched into a caterpillar, which then became a chrysalis, and then finally a butterfly. I got some very creative guests on my show today. Do you remember a few weeks ago I made a model house? Well, here I have three guests who've actually made a model village. Welcome to the show, Joanne, Michelle, and Mark. How on earth did you manage to do all this?
Easy.
Easy? How did you start?
First we did this.
Yes.
Making houses.
So you just put a piece of cardboard down,
yeah.
Made the houses.
Stuck two pieces together.
Oh, I see, yes. Drew the road. Oh, just so you had a plan of what to do.
Yeah.
What sort of houses have you got on here?
What's
this one? That's an inn. Right. Let's have a look at this one. What's that?
A bank.
That's a bank. Oh, you've written bank on the top, yes. And that's a chemist shop. And what's this one here?
A shopping arcade.
That's a shopping arcade.
It's a pub.
And the last one is a pub. What's the pub's name?
Parrot.
Parrot Pub. Who thought of that idea?
Me.
What a wonderful idea. And you've also named all the roads, different things. What's this one?
Rickshaw Lane.
And what's that one, Mark?
Monte Carlo Street.
And you've got a river running down
Rainbow
the centre. Rainbow River. What a lovely idea. And even this is a tennis court here.
Yes. Yeah.
It's a great idea. You've really done well. Was it difficult to make the houses? Did you find following the instructions hard?
No, it was okay.
Easy. You found it easy. Yeah. You've made a telephone box as well. Did you use the same method for that, or did you use a different one?
Different.
How did you do that?
I put a piece of paper and folded it into four.
And then you painted it,
and
like telephone box
and
in it.
Put a top and on it.
Well, well done. What an absolutely smashing effort they have done.
Door.
You've done really, really well. Well done. Do you make anything else?
Yeah, birds.
Birds. Well, I think we ought to give Joanna a chance to show us later on how we can make some birds. But now it's time for Would You Believe It? Last week on Would You Believe It, I showed you how to do a magic mind reading trick. And if you remember, I told you to think of a number between 1 and 9, multiply it by 5, then add 3, then times it by 2, and then I would tell you your original number. Well, as you realise, I'm not really doing a mind reading trick. I'm just doing a very easy type of maths trick, and this is how you do it. By multiplying a number by 5 and then later multiplying a number by 2, you have, in effect, multiplied it by 10. So the number you thought of simply moves from the units column to the tens column. And adding a 3 is just a way of tricking people, as it doesn't affect your answer at all. So all you have to do is ask your friend what their answer is, and then you know what their original number was. Let's have a look. Say their answer was 43. Well, then you know that the first number they thought of was the number 4. And if they say 73, then you know the first number they thought of must have been 7. Well, that was hard work, wasn't it? I think we're going to need a little break now. But stay tuned, because we've got a new Would You Believe It in part 2. Quickly grab your pens and paper, ready to jot down some great ideas coming up, and also details of our special competition. Would you believe that this is the letter B? Well, I know it's not actually the letter B, really, but if you write in secret code, then 2 becomes the number that stands for the letter B. You can also write in alphabetical code, but let's have a look and let me show you. If you write out the alphabet and then write the numbers from 1 to 26 underneath, then you can write in code. Well, there's a game using this idea that's called Busby's Boxes, so let's have a look and see if you know how you can play it. Here are some numbers in a box which stand for different letters, which make words going up and down. Well, as you can see, 13 equals M, 1 equals A, and 14 equals N. So we have the word man. And if we finish the box, it would look like this. There you are. I've filled in all the numbers now. So we've got man, age, and pot going across, and map, a go, and net going downwards. Why don't you have a go at home and see if you can do some Busby's Boxes for yourself? Actually, while you're at it, why don't you have a go and see if you can write the secret code for Swizzle Street? Now, all you have to do is reverse the process, look at the letters and work out what numbers should go with it. I'll start you off by giving you a clue. There we are. There's Swizzle Street, and S equals 19. Well, onto something completely different now. As you might know, Swizzle Street has been going for well over a year now. And within that time, we have collected an awful lot of books. Here they are, to name just a few. Now, I was moving the other day, as I told you earlier on, so I had a good clear out of the box, and some of them are mine and some of them are Sarah's. And what I wanted to do was find a good home for these books. Now, some of the books aren't exactly perfect. Some of them have a few notes written inside, but they're still really good to read. So if you can think of a charity or organisation, hospital or children's home, that might like to have a whole collection of books, new books to read, then why don't you contact me at Swizzle Street and I'll give you the address at the end of the show. Well, I wonder what's coming up next.
Danger Mouse!
Well, it's time now for details of our competition. I wonder if you know what a logo is. Well, logo is like a special badge for something, to identify something. Your school might have a logo or a badge showing the school's sign. Well, Swizzle Street has got a logo. Let's have a look at Swizzle Street's logo. There it is. That's the one I've been using for quite a while. But I've decided it's about time we had a new one. So I thought maybe we ought to have a competition to see if you at home, the viewers, can design a new logo for Swizzle Street. Well, this is what you have to do. Draw and colour a design or a pattern using the words Swizzle Street in no more than 3 colours. You can use black and white as extra colours if you want to. Make your picture about 20 centimetres by 20 centimetres. And make sure you write your name, age, address and your telephone number on the back of your design. And make sure all your entries get to me before Monday the 2nd of June, so that's quite a long time. The winner will receive a special ATV trophy, which is theirs to keep, and they will come onto the show to receive it. Not only that, they will also see their own design on anything that we use for Swizzle Street, like paper, badges, t-shirts, etc. So get designing, and make sure you do put your own name, your age, your address, and your telephone number on the back of your design. Otherwise, I won't know who to contact if you're the winner. Here's the address to write to. Write to Competition, Tracy King, Swizzle Street, ATV, room 430, 81, Broadcast Drive, Kowloon. Well, I shall look forward to hearing from you with all your entries. Well, it's time now for me to do some hard work because Joanne is going to show me how to make some paper birds in You Can Make It. Well, I'm really looking forward to this. It's about time I got some new ideas of things to do on the show. So this is the bird that you've made. Have a look at the other two, a pink one and a grey one. So a bluey grey. So what exactly do you need?
All you need is a piece of squared paper and some scissors.
Squared paper, just that size?
And some scissors.
And some scissors. All right then. Set to and show us what you're doing then. So you have to fold it
in half.
Diagonally, first of all. Why don't I make one alongside you? There. You have to be very precise, do you? Like that.
And then you go like that.
Go like this. So you fold it,
yeah,
sort of across the centerpiece.
Then you fold it in half.
Whoa, slow down. Which way?
That.
That way.
Yeah.
So that is that on the outside? Yes. Right. So that piece is on the outside. Okay. Fold it in this way.
Can you open it up?
Open it out.
And
pull this one out.
Yeah.
Right. Pull that one back. Okay.
Then you fold it in half.
Which way? That way.
Yeah.
Okay. Am I doing it right? No.
The other way.
So you get a plain side. Okay. That way.
Then you fold this back like that.
Fold that back like that. And turn it around and do the same, yes?
Yeah.
Okay.
This side.
I hope you're all following this at home.
Then you get the top. The head.
Yes.
And then you fold it over like that.
Ah. Wait a minute.
Yeah,
like
that's right.
That way. Okay.
Then you need.
I don't think I folded mine very carefully.
Then you get the scissors and you cut the tail shape. Like that.
Right, let's see if I can cut my tail shape then. Up there, and then
down there.
Across there. And that's it?
Yeah.
Isn't that clever? Well done. Well, I hope you all followed that at home. It was quite complicated, but I think if you work out your own way, you'd be able to see if you can do it. Well, I'm going to have a go at making another one now, because I don't think my effort was too brilliant. So I think we ought to say goodbye, and then I'm going to have a go at making another one, yeah?
Yeah.
All right, bye-bye then, and I'll see you next week. Bye-bye.
Stay tuned now for the Flintstones, coming up next here on ATV.